Manu.
Thank you for the kind welcome. Thank you, everyone of us. We are grateful to be here with us. We'll speak about Remplissage for the next few minutes. These are my disclosures. So when we speak about anterior instability, we speak mainly the essential lesion is the Bankart lesion, the anterior labral detachment. But and we perform, as you hear, the Bankart repair in order to restore the labrum to its anatomic position and to reestablish the appropriate tension to the glenohumeral ligaments and the capsule. But the long-term results of Bankart repair are not so satisfactory. So this is a study for with 186 patients with arthroscopic Bankart repair, and the recurrence rate in the 10 years follow-up is 30%. The average in the literature is from 20% to 40%. So this is why the anterior instability is not the Bankart lesion only, as you hear before. We consider the age of the patient, the type and the degree of sport participation, and the capsular laxity and the patient's hyperlaxity, which is the factors patient related. And also we have to confront the bone defects from the glenoid and the humeral side, which is the most important factor for the decision making. And we know from this classic study of Burkhardt that the recurrence rate is much bigger. It's bigger when the significant bone defects exist. And I believe that bone defects are everywhere. Even after the first dislocation, the 70% of patients has a humeral side or glenoid side bone defects, or both. And this is a study with 153 patients. They perform CT scan prior to Bankart repair, and no bony lesion was present only in 14% of the cases. And also, in this study, the authors from Japan performed a CT scan and made a 3D model of the shoulder and compared it to the other side. And bone defects were present in 88% of humeral heads and 97% of glenoids. So this is why the bone procedures are growing by the time goes by. Or else we can augment the Bankart repair, and these are some techniques to do it. We will speak from Remplissage. Remplissage is a French word that means fill in, and it's the capsulomyotenodesis of the posterior part of the shoulder inside the Hill-Sachs lesion. So the indication of Remplissage, according to Pascal Boileau, is isolated humeral bone defect. And in fact, he has the lowest recurrence rate in the literature with 2% following this indication. But too many other surgeons have expanded the indication to the combined bone defects. And also the concept of a glenoid tract and the concept of on-track and out-of-track lesion and the engaging Hill-Sachs lesion conclude that it's the combination of the bone defects and not its lesion separately. And when we confront bone defects, the question is, what's the critical bone loss? When we speak from the glenoid side, we have the critical size, 25%. We have the subcritical size, 13.5%. And year by year, this number getting lower. And from the humeral side, there are several classification systems, but controversy exists regarding which is optimal. Our experience has been published in a KST for the middle terms and the long-term results. We have studied 65 patients, operated with Bankart repair, augmented with Remplissage, and the follow-up was, the average follow-up was eight years. Our recurrence rate was 5.6%, and the rest of patients were satisfied and returned, most of them, in the sporting activities. The shoulder function was significantly improved, and the shoulder mobility was not significantly reduced, even neither clinically significantly reduced, even if there was a slight difference between the other side. When we are looking to the literature, we can find multiple clinical studies and multiple systematic reviews that support RPSAS due to the low recurrence rate, due to non or minimal motion loss, and the very low complication rate. And this is a study of 72 patients comparing bunker repair with bunker repair and RPSAS. The recurrence of the first group was 26%, and in the second group, 5%. Another study, 79 patients, the same comparison. The first group, recurrence 80% at 10 years mean follow-up. The second group, 0%. It's very optimistic, but this study has been published in Arthroscopy last year. And this is a cadaveric study, studying 8 specimens with, and the result was that bunker repair did not prevent the engagement in any shoulder with off-track heel sachs lesion, but when adding RPSAS to them, the engagement was prevented in every shoulder previously engaged. The complication of this procedure are very low. The complication rate in this systematic review studying the 18 clinical and 10 bioanalytical studies was 0.4%. And we used to compare with bony procedure. I believe we compare apples with watermelons, but the only thing that we can say is the complication rates of this procedure are much bigger. So our algorithm is that we try to restore the anterior glenoid problem for in the beginning, and then to reduce the posterior capsule, and then we try to augment the glenoid bony surface in order to when the significant bone loss or laxity exists. And this is the final result. Here is the posterior pouch of the shoulder in the beginning, and here is with RPSAS. So the take-home message is that RPSAS is a safe procedure, effective and valuable in the long term, reducing the recurrence rate and improving the outcomes. Anyone performing shoulder instability surgeries should be familiar with this technique and consider it to use it when the situation dictates it. Or simply, if you want your arthroscopic bunker repair to be durable for 10 years, you consider it to augment it with RPSAS. I will also remind the ESCAN Congress and the ESA Specialty Days, and we are waiting for you to the next shoulder course next year. Thank you very much.